Hi, this is Julie Harland, and I'm your math gal. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com where you could search for any of my videos organized by topic. This is part 8 of ellipses. We're going into more advanced topics than just simply graphing ellipses. We define an ellipse and other terms associated with ellipses, such as major and minor axes, foci, etc. And then we list the main facts about ellipses centered at the origin 0, 0. We've covered the basics of ellipses, which would be to know the equation of ellipse in standard form and also how to graph an ellipse. Now we're going to go on to some more advanced topics about ellipses, like, well, what is an ellipse by definition? So first of all, an ellipse is the set of all points in the plane, the sum of whose distances from two fixed points is a constant. I know that's a mouthful. When you have to put things in words, actually it sounds kind of complicated sometimes. And the fixed points are called the foci of the ellipse. Now, foci is the plural of the word focus. So it means you have one focus, which I'll call F1, and another focus, which I call F2. And it says that to find the points on the ellipse, the sum of the distance from the two fixed points is constant. So here's a way to imagine it. Take two nails, okay, in a piece on a board, okay, nail it in, okay, and then take a string that is longer than the distance from the two nails, okay. If it was just between the two nails, it won't work. You won't get an ellipse. You need something kind of longer. So you try to pull it taut. So imagine I have something kind of long that if I pull it taut, maybe it looks something like this, for instance. Then this would be a point on the ellipse. Imagine that's the string. Okay. Now I could pull it more taut. Maybe it's over here. So maybe this would be another point on the ellipse. And let's say I pull it all the way to the right and then back to here, right? Maybe it's something like that. So if you actually imagine pulling it taut, pulling it around, you get an ellipse. So you can find some videos on the internet where they actually do this with a nail and you get something like this. Okay, it depends on whatever the distance is. So you might have something that is a lot bigger than this. It just depends how long that string is. So you think of the length of the string as the constant. So we're going to do it for a particular example. What if I have two foci, 4, 1 and negative, 4, 0 and negative 4, 0, which I've put on this graph, and a constant of 10. Now, I'm actually showing where some of the points on the ellipse are already, and let me explain how I figured that out. If I have a constant of 10 and I'm pulling a string taut that's 10 units long, well, if I start pulling from this F2 and try to pull all the way to the right, the furthest I can get over is over here at 5, 0, and that would be 9 units, and then that would give me 1 unit to get back to here. I could pull it the other way, stretch it as far as possible. I end up over here at negative 5, 0. So these ordered pairs are on the ellipse. I've got 5, 0 and negative 5, 0. The foci is somewhere inside the ellipse. Now, why are these points here? 0, 3 and 0, negative 3. Okay, so here's the reason. If I just think about what I know about right triangles, and hopefully you know the Pythagorean theorem, notice this is a 3, 4, 5 triangle. So this is 4 units, and this is 3 units. Then this hypotenuse would be 5. So imagine if I pulled that string from F1 to F2, I'd have 5 for this side and 5 for that side, and that's how I figured that out. All right, so my ellipse goes through the 4 points you see, so it ends up looking like this. Okay, that's what an ellipse would look like if the foci were at 4, 0 and negative 4, 0, and if the constant, that constant we're talking about, ends up being 10. So here's a picture again, and I've kind of shown if you had these two lengths here adding up. I'm going to remove those now. Okay. All right, so you could see the ellipse and the foci. And we're going to throw out some more vocabulary here. The major axis is the axis that is on the same line where you've got the foci. So notice the foci are on the x-axis, okay? The major axis is the two endpoints of the ellipse on that line. So the major axis is this line segment AC. In other words, between those ordered pairs, negative 5, 0, and 5, 0. All right, so that is called the major axis. It's a line segment. And the vertices are the endpoints of that major axis, the negative 5, 0, and the 5, 0. Now, in previous videos, I said B and D here are also the vertices. They actually aren't called the vertices, they're called the endpoints of the minor axis. The minor axis is the other one, it's not as long. See how this one's longer? It's longer going in the horizontal direction. So the vertices are only the ones here, A and C. I labeled A, B, C, and D just so it was easier to state what the major and minor axis was. What's the length of the major axis? How far is it from A to C? That is 10. And what I want you to notice here is an easy way to get that is it's 5 to the right, 5 to the left. It ended up being just 2 times 5. Okay? All right, minor axis is BD. That's this other shorter one. So it's only that little line segment. And so what is the length of that from B to D? That would be 6. And it happens to be, by the way, 2 times 3. So B and D are the endpoints of the minor axis, and those are what order pairs? 0, 3 and 0, negative 3. So what I was trying to illustrate here is if you have 5 and negative 5 in here, that's where I got the 2 times 5. If you had 3 and negative 3 in here, that's where I got the 2 times 3. I'm looking at these numbers here. This is called a horizontal ellipse because it is longer in the horizontal direction. All right, if we look at this ellipse, hopefully that you understand that the equation of this ellipse in standard form, since it's centered at the origin, is x squared over 5 squared, because you notice the endpoints here are at 5, 0 and negative 5, 0, plus y squared over 3 squared equals 1. So there's the equation in standard form, because we have taken equations of ellipse in the standard form and graphed them. And so now when you look at a graph, you could also put it in standard form. So this is longer in the horizontal direction, so we call this a horizontal ellipse. The major axis is along the x-axis, okay? The length of the major axis is 10, which, look at the picture here. See that 5? That is just 2 times that 5. The minor axis is along the y-axis, the shorter length, and the length of that is 6, which is 2 times the 3. See the smaller number in the bottom. What are the vertices? The vertices I get from the bigger number here, and it's on the x-axis, will be 5, 0, and negative 5, 0. And the endpoints of the minor axis, we don't technically call these vertices, are, well, they're on the y-axis, right? So the smaller number's on the y-axis, so it's 0, 3, and 0, negative 3. And the foci, which were defined in the first place, were 4, 0, and negative 4, 0. Now I'm going to show you how to get those foci. The number, which is the important part, the 4, comes from this letter called C, and C squared is going to be just the bigger number minus the smaller number of the denominator. So it ends up being 5 squared minus 3 squared, which is 25 minus 9, which is 16. So think about it. If C squared is 16, that means C is plus or minus 4, and these are the numbers you use to get the foci. So now we're going to summarize this for any ellipse centered at the origin. Right, so here are the main facts about an ellipse centered at the origin. Here's the standard of an equation, the standard equation for an ellipse centered at the origin. So first we're going to talk about the horizontal ellipse, which is like the one we just did. It's horizontal if the number under the x is bigger than the number under the y. So if a is bigger than b, it's a horizontal ellipse. So the vertices are at, you look at the number under the x, right? For a squared, a0 and negative a0. And the length of the major axis is just 2 times a. Now we're assuming a and b are positive numbers. The endpoints of the minor axis, okay, so you take the smaller number is under the y squared, so it's going to be on the y-axis, 0b and 0 negative b, and its length will be 2b. Now how do we get this c squared? You just take the big number minus the small number. So c squared is a squared minus b squared. Once you figure that out, you could figure out c, okay? And the foci are going to be the same on the same axis as where the vertices are. So we have a0, we're going to have c0. I'm not going to show you where this comes from, this relationship between c squared, a squared, and b squared. C has to do with the foci, for instance, and a squared and b squared are the denominators when you have this in standard form. But this could be shown by using the definition of an ellipse, the distance formula, the triangle inequality, and itself is quite a lot to prove. It could be found in a pre-calculus book, but I'm not going to take the time to show you where that particular relationship comes from in this video. So this is, it's a lot to take in. We're kind of advanced here. This is a horizontal ellipse. Now, if instead the number under the y is bigger than the number of the x, it's very similar, but we're going to get a horizontal ellipse. So now I'm writing the same equation, okay? But now I'm going to say b is the bigger number. So what if b is bigger than a? It's a vertical ellipse. So the vertices are on the y-axis. So we have 0b. Again, we're taking the number under the y, 0b and 0 negative b. So the length of the major axis is 2 times b, 2 times the bigger number. The endpoints of the minor axis are at a0 and negative a0. So the length of the minor axis is 2a.